Good afternoon, good evening, good morning, wherever in the world we may find you. It's an honor to be here with you alongside my close colleagues and good friends, distinguished Americans all, to discuss U.S. foreign policy in Sub-Saharan Africa. My name is Reuben Brigety. I am the Vice Chancellor and President of the University of the South. You have access to online to the biographies of all of our distinguished speakers, so I won't belabor them, but let me just briefly introduce them to you. Ambassador Johnnie Carson, former Assistant Secretary of State for African Affairs. Ambassador Michelle Gavin, a former United States Ambassador to Botswana and U.S. Representative to SADC. And Dr. Monde Muyangwa, the Director of the African Program at the Woodrow Wilson Center. So in discussions on Africa, it's always a challenge to simultaneously address the particular immediate challenges of the day, while also thinking through broader term trends and opportunities and challenges. And so we are going to try to just do just that within the hour that we have to us. And so perhaps it's best for us to start with the most immediate of the immediate news of the day for Africa, and that is the killing of President Idriss Deby, the late president of Chad. Apparently at the hands of rebel forces while the president is visiting front lines. So Monday, I wonder if I might ask you to, and by the way, we're all going to be on a first name basis because we're all good friends.
Absolutely.
It's going to cut a few minutes off for our sort of recording titles. It's going to do that. I don't disrespect anybody. It's all to that level of familiarity. So, so Monday, I wonder if I might ask you to give us your sense of the implications of the killing of President Deby, and not only for Chad, but also for the Lake Chad Basin region.
Absolutely, and thank you, and good afternoon, good morning, good evening, everyone. I mean, we all got up to the news of President Deby's death this morning after 30 years of him being in office. You think about that, and it's been a whole generation of young people in Chad have known only one leader. You think about that, a whole region has interacted at the presidential level, at that leadership level, with just the one leader. And you look at Chad's role, both in the region and in the Sahel, and you know that his death is going to have some implications, both at home and in the region. At home, here's what I see for Chad. First, it's that the transitional council was announced for an 18-month period. And apparently there is debate about that having come at the expense of the president of the National Assembly. And so this usurpation of power and handing it over to the transitional council and away from the National Assembly could play into the potential dynamics of how the population reacts to this really, really tense transitional period. I think a second question for me would be how the military within Chad reacts. Are they going to stick together, or are we going to have factions within the military? And that could have implications for the timeline that's drawn out for the 18-month transition period, hopefully leading to elections and a return to civilian governance. So I think that's one piece of it. Obviously, how the transition is managed is going to be very important. Chad is in a very volatile neighborhood. All of its neighbors have some level of conflict. And so managing that transition is going to be key. On the regional level, Chad obviously plays a very important role in the Lake Chad Basin area. You have over 5,000 troops, French troops who are stationed in, play a critical role in the Lake Chad Basin area. And so I don't see anything at this point that would suggest that that role is going to change, at least in the immediate period. At least I haven't heard anything. But obviously that is something that we should be watching, the role that Chad plays, the critical security role that Chad plays within the Lake Chad Basin area. I think that's a second point for us to look at. A third dimension I would look at, and then I'll conclude here, is look, Chad is at the bottom of the Human Development Index, right? So it ranks 187 out of 189 countries. It also ranks quite high on the Corruptions Perceptions Index. So there's clearly a balancing act that we are going to, that the people of Chad and the international community is going to have to work with. We value the role that Chad plays in the Lake Chad Basin area, but we recognize the governance shortcomings and challenges at home. So how do we manage those two things to ensure that the Transition Council is able to move Chad towards this more inclusive democratic governance model, attend to some of the issues of the human rights concerns and the issues of human security? I think that's going to be key in the next few months.
Thanks, Monde. We could spend the entire hour talking about all the views articulated, not only as they relate to Chad, but also as broader themes. And we'll come back to many of them. But for the moment, I mean, let me go to Michelle, if I may. I know, Michelle, we were talking just before we got on that the first time you met President Deby, it was quite memorable. I'll let you sort of share that if you'd like. Even as I ask you to take us to the opposite end of the continent to address the other conflagration that's fighting in northern Mozambique and the massive population displacement that has occurred, as well as the fighting for rebels there and the implications for the government in Maputo. So, Michelle.
Thank you. And it's such a pleasure to join all of my fellow panelists here, all people I respect and would love to just listen to them for an hour. But I'm glad we're talking about Mozambique because it is an incredibly worrying set of circumstances affecting the Southern African region, which has been, you know, relatively speaking, one of the most stable, most peaceful, most able to focus on economic integration, and the agenda has not been a counterinsurgency agenda. But in Mozambique, what we're seeing is an insurgency that has been gaining in strength despite the efforts of Mozambican security services and private military contractors working for the government of Mozambique to counter it. So they've been gaining in sometimes able to hold territory for periods of time. The attacks have become more daring and more significant. The human cost continues to rise with hundreds of thousands of people displaced, thousands killed. And you now have SADC, which is the sub-regional organization for Southern Africa, feeling pressure to act. No one wants to see this kind of insurgency take hold in Mozambique and metastasize from there. But it's also true that SADC isn't terribly well equipped to address this kind of problem. It's one of the least dynamic of the sub-regional organizations. And the government of Mozambique itself has been hesitant to accept regional intervention and has stressed the importance of Mozambican sovereignty despite their inability to deal with the problem. I think two things that I think are really important for kind of the general observer of Africa to keep in mind here. Well, three. One, Mozambique is of course the site of the largest LNG investment in the world, Total's investment of many billions of dollars. And these attacks are occurring right in the area where construction has been underway. So it's really kind of calling into question the sustainability of that kind of massive investment in extractives in a country that's not as stable as it may have appeared. And that leads me to the second and I think most fundamentally important point, which is that there is no military solution likely to this problem. And the lessons that we've learned from metastasizing types of terrorist movements in the Sahel and elsewhere should tell us that addressing this strictly as a security issue is unlikely to be successful. There are long-standing problems in this area of Mozambique that's been marginalized for decades, and a sense that government has not paid very much attention to extending services to inclusive growth. So there are really kind of fundamental political and governance issues that ultimately, it's very difficult for me to see this problem being resolved without very serious attention to those issues. And that does not appear to be in the offing. The government of Mozambique does not appear willing to grapple with that. And then the last thing, of course, is the regional implications for Southern Africa. I think it's, you know, an interesting test for SADC to see, you know, can it be effective again? And it's a problem for East Africa too, because these forces have attacked inside Tanzanian territory. You know, if you're an East African country looking at the mess in the Horn of Africa, which I know we'll discuss, longstanding terrorist organizations along the East African coast, and now this new uptick in Mozambique, I don't think anyone's feeling very comfortable.
Well, thanks, Michelle. And I, you know, appreciate in particular you're noting how the conflagration in northern Mozambique not only is an upset to what was arguably the most stable region in the continent with the most likelihood for economic development, and what the implications of this violence are for future economic development and also for the rest of the region. We'll come back to all that on our next round of those broader themes. And Johnnie, and by the way, it's hard for me, not saying that you're a friend, it's hard for me to call you Johnnie. It's like hard for me to call my dad, like by his first name, but whatever, right? we're gonna go with it for today. So in a continent full of challenges, arguably the most complex and the most profound at the moment is Ethiopia. With a war, however one wishes to classify it, in the country, upcoming elections, and the second most populous country that is also the diplomatic seat of Africa. So what do you think?
Thanks, Reuben. It's a pleasure to be with you and with the other guests this afternoon. I agree with you. Ethiopia is facing an enormous number of complex and overlapping domestic and regional challenges. And these challenges are occurring, as you point out, in Africa's second most populous state, and in a region that has been known for its fragility and instability over the last couple of decades. Ethiopia is facing a domestic challenge with respect to the crisis and conflict and war that has been raging in Tigray in the northeastern part of the country since November. That war was touched off by a dispute over the central government's decision to delay national elections because of COVID, and then a complex set of arguments about one side acting against the other militarily. I won't go into who actually touched off the conflict, but the domestic conflict in Tigray has unleashed an enormous humanitarian crisis, a crisis of extraordinary complexity, and one that has seen war crimes, crimes against humanity, rape as an instrument of war, and the wanton destruction of capital assets, schools, homes, crops, churches, and manufacturing facilities. We have also seen the involvement of Eritrea. Eritrean troops came into this conflict, probably at the behest of the Ethiopian government. And they also have been involved in the enormous humanitarian and war crimes that have occurred there. We have seen the displacement of hundreds of thousands of IDPs, some fleeing into the southern parts of Ethiopia, some fleeing across the border into Sudan. But with respect to this current crisis in Tigray, it is really, really important for at least four or five things to happen. One is that there must be a continuing effort to speed up and expand humanitarian access to people who are in desperate need. There is a continuing need, secondly, for all Eritrean troops to leave Ethiopia. Third, there must clearly be some investigation thoroughly, independently, that investigates and finds out who did what to whom, and that those individuals responsible for war crimes, for rape, and for the carnage and destruction, they must in fact be brought to justice. And finally, but not the least, there must be an end to what appears to be the stigmatization of individuals from different ethnic groups, particularly those who are from Tigray and Tigrinya speakers who live in other parts of Ethiopia. All of these things are an absolute must. But this is only one of the many crises and challenges facing Ethiopia. Ethiopia, prior to the outbreak of conflict in Tigray, was in the process of a historic transformation, one that could ultimately lead to a greater democratic inclusion. One hopes that the political reforms that were beginning to be undertaken by the Prime Minister Abiy's government will in fact continue. Elections are to be held in that country on June 5th, and we hope that those elections will in fact be free, transparent, creditable, and most of all, peaceful. But it is an important period of transition. But these are not the only challenges that this country faces. Those are domestic challenges. The regional challenges include the issue of the GERD, the Grand Ethiopian Renaissance Dam. The neighboring countries of Egypt and Sudan have been quite vocal and vociferous in their efforts to have Ethiopia slow down the completion of the filling of the dam in order to ensure that their Nile, Blue Nile riparian rights are honored. Negotiations between the three countries have been underway now for close to 2.5 years. And no agreement has in fact at this point has no point has this agreement been completed. The AU under the chairmanship of President Tshisekedi of the DRC is working to facilitate negotiations. We hope that this will be worked out in an amicable fashion, but it is also important that Egypt and those in Egypt who are concerned about Nile waters do not engage in hostile war mongering rhetoric, which we have seen over the past 6 or 7 months. But it is an important issue. When the GERD is completed, it will be Africa's largest dam, both in size and in the capacity to produce electricity. And it is possible that the benefits from this dam will not only help Ethiopia, but also contribute not only to the other two countries, Sudan and Egypt. In addition, we have challenges between Ethiopia and Sudan on the border that emanate in large part out of the conflict in Tigray. And we see coming out of this complex, unfortunately, the emergence of the Eritrean president, Isaias Afwerki, as being a new and concerning and troublesome force in the region. I'll stop right there. As I said, it is an enormously important country, Africa's second largest in terms of population. And prior to the beginning of the conflict in last year, we were seeing, and before COVID, I might add, before 2019, Ethiopia had one of the fastest growing economies in Africa. An important country that we should all pay particular and special attention to.
Johnnie, thank you very much for that comprehensive overview of an enormously complex situation. And Monday, we just highlighted three. We could have gone over many more issues affecting the continent. And I'm wondering from your perspective, and we're just barely 100 days in to the new Biden presidency. Now, obviously, all of these conflicts have their own endogenous forces that are at play. And the United States also has to make strategic decisions about how it's going to engage. And I'm just wondering if you might sort of take stock of the ability of the US government to engage meaningfully and impactfully on the continent over given the last 4 years. And what the Biden administration is inheriting in terms of both the nature of the conflicts and its ability to engage from the Trump administration.
Sure. No, thank you very much, Reuben. That's a really important question. And I thought what I would do is approach it from an African perspective, what Africans think the Biden administration is inheriting from the Trump administration on Africa, because I think that's going to be a very, very important dimension to how we engage. And so let me start with this. There's definitely some continuity, if you will, that I hear from my African colleagues when I talk to them about the Trump administration and what they how they approached Africa. And that continuity, I think, I'd pointed in two places. One is I think every president has had at least one signature program on Africa or initiative on Africa. And the Trump administration continued that with the Prosper Africa initiative. So that was definitely noticed. A second point that many of my African colleagues point to is the bipartisan support for Africa in Congress, that continued within the Trump administration. We got the Build Act. We got PEPFAR renewed. And so there's several markers that you could point to there in terms of that continuity as far as how the US has traditionally approached Africa. But the Trump administration, in the minds of many Africans, is leaving behind some challenges for the Biden administration to think through. The first one that I would speak to has to do with the fact that some of the Obama era Africa focused programs were often under threat of being defunded. And the way that was read on the African continent, which first of all, you have the first Black president, his Africa programs are under threat of being defunded. So that sent a message. We may not have intended to send that message, but we did send that message. A second dimension of that, I think, is much more long-term, that if we are going to pivot from one program to another, depending on who's office, to what extent can the American government be trusted to continue these partnerships long term beyond individual administrations. That's definitely a thought in the minds of many Africans that I have talked to. So that's one area. The second point I hear from my African colleagues is that under the Trump administration, there was definitely a sense that Africa, which was never really at the center U.S. Foreign policy, was moving even further away from, you know, the center of U.N. foreign policy considerations and priorities. And they cite several things in this regard. One, we had the tone and tenor of the engagement or speaking about Africa, whether it was tweets, messages that were sent, that definitely sent a message and left a message. The second area, and I've heard many Africans reference this, our treatment of the AU chairperson when he visited Washington. And I think a number of my African colleagues have said, you know, that was a clear indication of where Africa stood, because the United States would never have done that, say, to the head of the European Union. And so again, you know, we sent that message. Whether it's what we intended to do or not is besides the point, but that's the message that was received. A third point under that is in the proposed budgets that came out, the number of Africa-focused institutions that were always on the list of programs or agencies to be defunded. You know, whether you're talking the African Development Foundation or the Millennium Challenge Corporation, you're talking about some USAID programs that had a huge stake in Africa. That again, that sent a message. And of course, the famous or infamous travel bans, whichever way you want to call it, that disproportionately, I think, focused on African countries. So there was this sense that Africa really wasn't at the center before, but that it moved even further out of the center of US priorities and thinking. A third area that I hear from my African colleagues has to do with what they perceive as the diminishment of multilateralism during the Trump administration or the Trump era. So whether it was pulling out of the World Health Organization or pulling out of the Paris Accord or talking about defunding peacekeeping, while not directly just focused on Africa, these are issues that are very, very important to African countries. And the African continent in general. You're talking issues of climate change. You're talking issues of, you know, health with the World Health Organization, and you're talking peacekeeping issues. And as many African colleagues have reminded me over the years that if the Trump administration, rather than threaten to pull out funding from peacekeeping, had said, we're gonna lead the charge on how we reform peacekeeping. We should not be having peacekeeping missions in the DRC for over 20 years. We should not be having this on-off again situation in the Central African Republic, that the US is in a very good place to lead that reform effort, because clearly, you know, the peacekeeping element of it is not working as well as we want it to work. So those are some of the issues that I heard from my African colleagues. But I'll also add this, that, you know, I sat in a number of fora with African leaders in various parts of the continent. And one of the things that I heard was that the US government is too focused, and they're not saying this started during the Trump administration, but that this has been going on for several administrations now, that the US government perhaps is too focused on the security dimension of what they see as, you know, every problem has become a security problem in their analysis, when in fact, you know, there are other issues, priorities that we could be looking at, say, how do we help restore democracy and good governance on the African continent? It's under threat, not just in Africa, but also in other places. But as they look at the funding lines for democracy, those have been going down over several years. So I think those are some of the concerns in terms of the perceptions that Africans have, that the Biden administration has a lot of work to do, both in terms of tone of engagement, in terms of substance of engagement, and in terms of priorities within that substantive engagement of the new strategy. And they would also add that they are hoping that the Biden administration does not take 2 years to unveil the national security strategy for Africa, because that also was another message that people received or read to mean, you know, Africa really doesn't matter. We can wait, you know, 2 years before we unveil that. So those are some of the key issues in terms of the inheritance from an African perspective.
Great. Thanks, Monde. Let me say to pardon my my CFR colleagues who are managing the event, I am mindful of the time. I promise we'll end on time. I'll promise we're going to get to Q&A. But I also, let me sort of go quickly to Michelle and Johnnie. I have two other points that I think are incredibly relevant, Monde, to what you said. So for Michelle, for you, Monde laid it out. Certainly that last point, that the Biden administration is going to have to come up with a plan. What's it going to be? What do you think it ought to be? And what ought they be thinking about?
Well, I agree with you. I think Monde's sort of analysis of perceptions on the continent dovetails pretty well with how we might think about things going forward. You know, one of the things the Trump administration did was, when they did try and frame up Africa in a strategic sense, it was in the context of major power competition with China. And while I don't think that's a terribly useful lens for kind of fundamentally thinking about what the priorities of policy should be, or the universe of possible partnerships, I think it's far too narrow a lens. One thing that is helpful about it is it did force a recognition that there is a geopolitical competition regarding norms, global governance norms and standards, how the international system operates, and what we've all kind of signed up to as being beyond the pale, acceptable, how states relate to each other. These kind of fundamental global governance questions are on the table. And I do think that should be an important starting point for the Biden administration in thinking about its engagement with Africa, because we're talking about the youngest region of the world, a region of the world that will very shortly represent 25% of the global population, fastest urbanizing. You know, gone are the days, one would hope, when Africa is some kind of afterthought or you know, sideshow to a general strategy about how the U.S. wants to position itself in the world. And here I think, you know, the interim national security strategic guidance that the Biden administration released is really instructive because it stresses the importance of multilateralism, as Monde was just discussing. And so if we're serious about that, and I hope we are, because I think they're on the right track, that's going to mean intense engagement with African capitals. Africa has a huge voice in multilateral institutions, and we have not always done a good job of trying to find, in the Venn diagram of shared interests and values, those areas where we can work together to bolster norms that are in our interest as well as theirs. So when it comes to sort of the shape of multilateral institutions and the rules of the road going forward, there's going to have to be intense consultation and awareness of African needs, African agency, the reforms they'd like to see in the multilateral system that for too long has marginalized African voices. I think that's essential. It's also essential for us to deal with an existential threat like climate change. There is no way to address this problem without a global solution. You can't leave Africa out, and they are energy starved, and with a constantly growing population like they have, and the job creation imperatives on the African continent, we are going to have to reckon with their energy needs in a much more serious way than we have to date. The last thing I would say about this is that interim guidance also stressed the importance of addressing democratic decline and this backslide into authoritarianism. So here, the perennial tension in Africa policy between our desire for stability and our concerns about human rights and democracy is going to have to get a really hard look, because ultimately we have to ask ourselves just how stable a state is if it depends on one strong man. And we've seen this, you know, come into sort of very stark relief recently in Uganda. I think we're seeing it come into relief in Chad. And it's really going to take some rebalancing, a real reckoning with what do we really mean by stability if we're going to try and move out on this agenda to push back against authoritarianism.
And the people said amen on all of the above. And Johnnie, if I could ask you to close this portion of our session before we go to Q&A on the issue that clearly always has bipartisan support, and that's business. And talk, one of the things I frankly was just surprised by in looking back at the Trump administration is they did not make a much heavier play during their time on rallying American business engagement on the continent. It seemed to be an obvious one given the previous president's orientation. And I was wondering if you could talk a bit more about how you see the potential for American economic business engagement in the continent playing out over the course of the next 4 to 5 years.
Thank you. I think that it is extraordinarily important for the U.S. government and for the American business community to recognize the enormous potential that exists across Africa. A continent of 54 states, 1.3 billion people. We have 2.5 trillion dollars worth of GDP and economy across the continent. And it is a continent that Michelle has pointed out that is growing enormously rapidly. It is the youngest and fastest growing population. It has large and expanding middle class. It is a continent that is urbanizing very, very rapidly. And all of this says consumer business, economy, and trade when you look at it. One of the more important things that was done during the Trump administration, largely coming out of the Congress, supported by both Democrats and Republicans, was the creation of the International Development Finance Corporation, which takes over all of the responsibilities of the former Overseas Private Investment Corporation, OPIC, as well as some of the responsibilities that existed inside of USAID that were designed to promote trade and investment. The new DFC is more powerful than the old OPIC because not only can it guarantee loans for American investments, the new legislation empowers the DFC to actually make structured investments in opportunities that may come up. It can put money and skin in the game. It has some $60 billion worth of money that is supposed to go to it to support investment and loan guarantees and loans across the globe. One of the things that could, in fact, be very powerful for Africa is to have the Congress and the administration expand the amount of money that goes into DFC and allocate a certain percentage of that money specifically for investments and use in Africa. That would be a very powerful way to demonstrate by this administration that it means business in doing business in Africa. Another important thing to look at is the AGOA, the African Growth and Opportunity Act, has been in existence now for roughly 25 years. It expires in 2025. And it is important not to let that legislation go down without new legislation that comes in that is designed to strengthen U.S. trade and investment in Africa. And as we do so, we need to take into account that Africa has also made some enormous progress in the last year and a half by the signing of a new Africa Continental Free Trade Agreement. That agreement has been initialed by all 54 of Africa's states, and some 36 or 37 have ratified the instruments that put it in power. As the U.S. looks at its trade relationships with a growing and dynamic Africa, it should, in fact, take into account what the Africans are doing themselves to break down barriers and to promote not only regional trade, but also greater international trade. And we need to be doing that now, right now. It is important also that we move very rapidly to increase the work that we do at USTR and also at the Department of Commerce. We need trade officers across Africa, not the few that we have had, but we need to strengthen our commercial attachés, strengthen our trade hubs, and put more energy and effort into reaching out and being on the ground to promote those trade and investment opportunities that exist in a fast-growing continent and a continent that is entrepreneurial in its nature and a continent which is young and dynamic in its character.
Well, Johnnie, thank you very much for that wonderful summation. And we now have, I think, just under 20 minutes for Q&A. So I'll ask our colleagues, the CFR technical staff, to tee up our questions and answers. So Sam, please, over to you.
Thank you so much. Ladies and gentlemen, as a reminder to ask a question, please click on the raise hand icon on your Zoom window. When you are called on, please accept the unmute now button and proceed with your name, affiliation, and question. And as a reminder, this meeting is on the record. Our first question will be from Frank Wisner. And as a reminder, please state your affiliation.
Frank Wisner of the law firm Squire Patton Boggs and a veteran, along with Johnnie Carson, of many seasons on the African continent. Michel, my question is directed to you. You gave a very useful summary of the main lines of the Biden administration's approach to Africa. One you didn't mention is the priority the administration has given at the outset to working with allies, particularly our European, not to mention our Asian allies. Africa is vitally important for economic reasons, for migration reasons, for security reasons. How do you see the administration operationalizing cooperation with allies in our approaches to Africa?
Thank you so much for that question. I agree with you. There's an awful lot of shared interests at stake. A stable and prosperous Africa is good for the international system. It's good for all of us. So I think that there are a range of different possibilities, from peacekeeping reform, as Monde brought up earlier, which it's still, the steps that have been taken at the UN, I don't know anyone who's satisfied with them to date. And there can be work done there critically with African partners coming along. But for all of the states that are, major contributors to peacekeeping operations, this just makes good sense. But then, when I do think about what the US has to offer, some of the things that Johnnie discussed with the DFC, which is a wonderful innovation, but still pales in comparison to the amounts that, say, China's been able to invest in infrastructure and other critically important priorities for African states, you know, a more deliberate and thoughtful effort to work with European partners, to work with the Japanese, to sometimes work with the Indians, where our interests align so that we can, you know, punch sort of with a bit more oomph in terms of the dollars that we can bring to the table for important projects, in addition to the standards that we can bring to the table that we're constantly talking about. But standards don't get you much if you don't actually have the money to invest in things that African states very much need. So I do think a more collaborative approach, as you suggest, is clearly in our interest. But you know, all of that takes elevating Africa on the agenda when we're talking to partners in Asia and in Europe. It really takes a soup to nuts understanding that this is not a side project or something for just the development folks to think about. And that is, I think, a hard mindset, to be candid, in the US foreign policy establishment to change.
Excellent. Our next question comes from Patricia Rosenfield.
Thank you very much. And thank you for this wide-ranging conversation. Even though I wasn't sure where we were going at the beginning, I really like where we are now. And I hope we'll have many more, especially taking off from these last points. Patricia Rosenfield, I'm at the Rockefeller Archive Center and the Rosenfield Fund, but my question is drawing on many years of working with African colleagues leading the Developing Countries Program at Carnegie Corporation. So one of the things in terms of what Michelle just said, and greetings, Michelle, it's been a while, about how to elevate Africa on the agenda. I'd like to ask each of you if the way to start is at home and renegotiate, renew AGOA, for instance, to look at all the other cultural agreements, to look at everything from NGO to political agreements requires African countries and the African continent having a higher priority in the United States. I don't see the champion in Congress right now, let alone the Biden administration. I'm wondering, and Monde knows from her work with the National Summit on Africa, how challenging this is. So I would like to hear how to accentuate maybe more positive developments so that Americans in this very complicated situation we are now in this country with our own cultural issues, how do we go about celebrating successes in Africa? And where would you start? Ghana being a tremendous, instead of starting with the, I think this may be a case for accentuating the positive so that we have Americans giving higher priority and we have the ability to elevate, we have the credibility for elevating Africa on the agenda in the international community.
If I might take the prerogative of the chair to add an addendum to Ms. Rosenfeld's very important question. It's this: given everything that all of our distinguished panelists have said at this panel, and that we've heard been said in so many authors about the obvious security and economic interests the United States has at play in Africa, why is it perpetually so hard to elevate these matters on the foreign policy agenda of the United States? Johnnie, you want to start with that one?
Sure. I'd start with a number of comments. First of all, we have to take Africa seriously. We also have to recognize Africa's intrinsic importance. We have to recognize its growing importance as a member of the international community. And for me, that means saying, let's expand the Security Council and push for two new permanent non-voting members on the Security Council, if not more. We need to make sure that the G20 is no longer the G20, but the G22, and ensure that Nigeria and South Africa are always at the table for major international discussions. We must recognize Africa's expanding economic and commercial markets and its enormous trading potential. That can be seen in its rapidly growing population. It is also seen in its rising and expanding middle class. We must take advantage of the entrepreneurial spirit that exists across the continent. And we must put in place senior leadership in our institutions at state, commerce, FC, DFC, and places like that, individuals who are going to be voices and champions. And the administration at the very top must show continuous high-level interest and engagement. It means more money for DFC targeted towards Africa. It means more engagement by our senior leadership towards Africa as a whole. I'm gonna say that I think that the Biden administration has actually gotten off to a very good start. And I think some of the outreach made by the president after coming into office to senior African leaders, reaching out to the AU with a widely wide-ranging public service message. I think the appointments of the at the senior level have been extremely good. I think Linda Thomas Greenfield in New York, and I certainly know that both Jake Sullivan and the Secretary of State are both individuals who travel to Africa and who seem to be taking a direct interest in some of the difficult crises on the continent. But this is just a beginning. There will be a need for a quick strategy. There will be a need to ensure that we have good trade legislation and that the White House takes an interest in doing what the Obama administration did, but more. It's time for us to make sure that every 2 years there is a summit, a business and political and security summit with African leaders. We're behind the curve on this issue. We have to show up and we have to be engaged and we have to take it seriously. And our leaders have to get to the continent and they must speak clearly about our values. We must take it seriously and we must look and value Africa's intrinsic importance as a large multilateral player with a continent which is going to be extraordinarily important in years to come as a trading partner. And if we ignore it, we lose the economic opportunities, the political friendships, the alliances. It's something that's important now. We're probably at an inflection point where we need and must do more, and we must do it better, and we must do it with a set of principles that indicate that we are doing it because we believe it.
Thanks, John. I was wondering if I might ask the forbearance of my other two panelists, see if we can try to squeeze in at least one more question before we go. So Sam, over to you.
Our next question is from Whitney Debevoise.
Thank you. This is Whitney Debevoise of Arnold and Porter, also a former USED at the World Bank. I have a question in my mind about what's been said about multilateralism, because my observation of the African behavior at the World Bank was that it was very much the behavior of a supplicant and not as a leading force in multilateralism. We created an extra chair for Sub-Saharan Africa. And what happened? It was raw politics. Nigeria and South Africa said, thank you very much. We'll take that chair for ourselves. And all the other countries were left in the same position they were in before. But really, in terms of a bilateral, you know, relations and initiatives, why can't we initiate something very powerful for Africa in the vaccine area? Show that we can really make the African Union work. Show that multilaterals like UNICEF can work in Africa. Things like that strike me as concrete things that we could do to get off to a very good start and show that we care.
Monde, might I ask you to address that? I mean, what more can we do to support multilateralism in Africa, both through our own actions and also on the continent on their own terms? You're muted. Monde, you're muted.
I am muted. Thank you. I said that's a really, really important question. Look, there is no doubt that the two superpowers that you have on the African continent play that role within the continent. Having said that, there's a lot of discussion that's going on in the African continent in terms of how they amplify or coordinate and amplify their voices in various various seats of power around the world, whether it's in Washington, in New York, in Geneva. There's a whole lot of that going on. There are measures that are being taken to ensure that seats revolve in this multilateral fora. So it's not just Nigeria, South Africa, or Egypt, or Algeria that's at the center of that. It's not yet perfected, but people understand that in the same way that they are calling for democratization of international organizations, which Ambassador Carson talked about, that also has to happen on the African continent. And personally, I feel pretty confident that they're moving in the right direction. They're not entirely there. There are certain issues that Nigeria and South Africa's voice is always going to be the driver for the continent. But I think if you look at it more broadly, the measures and the mechanisms that they are talking about putting into place to make sure that the African voice more broadly is represented, I think those are coming along quite nicely. On the COVAX, I don't know, I haven't really followed what the Biden administration has done as far as working with the African Union Centers for Disease African CDC, but I think that's going to be important. Engagement with the African CDC is going to be really, really important for the Biden administration. They have put in place a plan, a strategy, and I would argue that the COVID situation would have been far worse without the AU and the CDC and their partners' work and on that issue. So I think really figuring out how the Biden administration can support the African Centers for Disease Control, can work with the AU, can strengthen health systems across the continent, because I think it's just a matter of time before we get to the next pandemic. So what have we learned during COVID? How do we strengthen the infrastructures so we can better deal with it? And I think we can do, the U.S. can play an important role in that. And I would start with the African CDC.
Great. Thanks, Monde. And Sam, by my Apple watch, we are coming right in at 6 p.m. Eastern time. So hopefully I will not be fired as moderator. And I turn the program, sir, back over to you.